Should we just get a few details straight? So yeah. We're going to have to climb how many feet?
All together to the belfry, 205.
And how many steps is that?
334.
So you've got to be pretty fit.
Yes.
What about the actual title of the place? We think of it as Big Ben, the Tower of Big Ben. Is that actually the title for it?
It's the clock tower. It says so on the door here.
So where did Big Ben come from?
Big Ben is the nickname of the Great Bell. Official name, Great Bell, but everybody calls the Big Bell, Big Ben.
It's a wonderful spiral staircase with this wrought iron balustrade and looking up. Goodness, it's the opposite of vertigo. You're looking up layer after layer after layer of the spiral staircase. I think you've got a good head for heights. So John, when was the clock tower built?
It was completed 1859.
And who designed it?
Charles Barry, together with Augustus Pugin. He was interested in the decorative side of it.
Let's save our breath for the climb. Phew, we've arrived at moderately level ground. Where are we now?
Right.
We're in the prison room.
Prison room?
Yeah, 114 steps so far. About a third of the way. This is called the prison room. This is because we kept an MP here one night when he wouldn't behave himself. It's true. When you become elected an MP in this country, you can't take your place in the chamber or take part in proceedings unless you first swear allegiance to the Queen or King. In 1880, Charles Bradlaugh, he was elected MP for Northamptonshire. And when it comes to swearing in, he says, "Can't do that. I'm an atheist. I don't believe in the Bible. Can I please affirm or promise my loyalty?" They said, "No, you can't." So in return, he refused to leave. He interrupted the proceedings. He tried to swear himself in. And basically, they got fed up with him, arrested him, and kept him up here overnight. A couple of years later, they passed the Affirmation Act, which now allows MPs to swear on the Bible or not. They can swear on any religious item they want or not, as long as they promise their allegiance.
Phew. How far above ground are we here?
Right. If you have a look in the door here, on the floor, you'll see the figure 182. 182 steps so far, just about halfway. Big Ben is the name of the Great Bell, or the Owl Bell. And we had two attempts at making that. We wanted a 14-ton bell, which at that time would have been the biggest bell in the country. So they went to a foundry, a place called Norton, near Stockton-on-Tees, cast the Great Bell up there. Came in at 16.5 tons. And the tower wasn't ready for it, so they put it up in the gantry, and it tested it. And that was all right until a few months later, along came Mr. Dennison. He's the man who designed it, and he wasn't happy. He wanted a bigger sound, so he doubled the hammer size to 0.5 ton. And after 3 weeks, it broke. We'd had it for 10 months, so we had to go out to tender again. And this time, Mears of Whitechapel give us a 13.5 ton bell. And they took the Great Bell up in one lift. It took 32 hours continuous winding by 8 men at a time. And it's up there now. We're at the clock mechanism room. This is the Great Clock, or the Westminster Clock. It's the largest, most powerful, most accurate public clock in the world. Mechanical, of course.
There's a wonderful inscription in raised metal along the frame of the clock. This clock was made in the year of our Lord, 1854, by Frederick Dent of the Strand and the Royal Exchange, clockmaker to the Queen, from the designs of Edmund Beckett Denison, QC. Fixed here, 1859.
Correct. It's 15 feet long, 4 feet wide, 18 inches on the bed plate, and total weight is 5 tons. This section here, this set of wheels, is known as the strike train. All that does is operate the hammer for Big Ben. If you come over this way, this one's going to work shortly. This is called the quarter train, or the chiming train. This is the one that actually plays the tune. Like that.
That's the quarter hour.
That's quarter hour, yes. When they decided to have a clock up here, one of its criteria was it had to be accurate to a second a day. Now, this was unheard of in Victorian times. In Victorian times, if you had a turret clock running at a minute or 2 minutes a day accuracy, it was considered to be a pretty good clock. Now, if you have a look on the thing down there, you'll see a stack of pennies.
These are old copper pennies?
Old copper pennies. Now, if you put one of these pennies on that stack, you'll speed the clock up by 2/5 of a second a day. If you take a penny off, you'll slow it down by 2/5 of a second a day.
That's loud. Wow, coming through the door suddenly, here we are, behind the big glass roundel of the clock face. It's stunning.
So have a look by number 9 up there. Can you see the shadow of the minute hand? It moves every 2 seconds. That's because we have a 2-second pendulum. Every time the clock goes tick, the hands move.
There it goes, inch by inch.
And the hour hand is up there as well. The face itself is 23 feet across, made out of cast iron sections, and there's 312 bits of glass in it. Weight of each face is 4 tons. The minute hand is 14 feet long, it's a hollow copper tube. The hour hand is solid bronze at 9 feet. If you like to look that way at the lighting, originally we used to burn gas. And that's what the hoops in the wall are for, the gas man to climb up and light the gases. Because the lights go on at sunset and switch off at sunrise. 1906, we put electric light bulbs in. And then in 1994, we put these in. These are low-energy, high-efficiency, long-life bulbs. We went green long before anybody else did.
So at night, that glowing clock face that you see on the skyline is powered by these bulbs?
28 of them. Now, we clean the face, these faces, by every 5 years.
I can imagine it's relatively easy to clean the inside of the face, but the outside might present one or two problems.
What we do is we get all of half a dozen young fellas, tie ropes around them and push them off the top. They abseil down on the outside. Well done, you made it.
Whoa, so this is the top. Here's the bell. Here's Big Ben.
Yes.
And there's London all around us on a rainy day. Of course, there's not just the one bell, there's several to ring the chimes.
Yes, 4 quarters. And the great bell. Keep an eye on number 3 bell up there. That's the first hammer to move. As soon as that moves, you've got half a second to plug your ears, otherwise you will jump. Right, so this is Big Ben. 7'6" high, 9 foot wide, 8 inches thick, weighs 13.5 tons. 3 months after this one was put up here, it cracked.
What effect does that have on the chime?
None. The crack doesn't go all the way through the bell. It's only about 1¼ inches deep. He's supposed to ring E below middle C, but unless you've got perfect pitch, you wouldn't find out he's just ever so slightly flat. It's not the biggest bell in the world. It's no longer the biggest bell in the country, but it's the most famous bell in the world. And that's because millions of people listen to it every day and can recognise it. We transmit the sound live on the BBC at 6 p.m. and midnight. And millions of people listen to it.